dear beloved and respected brothers and sisters. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Al-aqibah lil-muttaqeen. وسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله عليه الصلاة والسلام الحمد لله It's a great honor and privilege to be among you and to have this opportunity to share with you some of the thoughts and experiences that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has bestowed upon me and all of us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created us as very unique creatures, human beings, ashraful makhluqat. And among human beings, He has guided us to the great deen and path of Islam. And among all Muslims, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has favored us to live in such an environment and be Muslims in such a society that Islam is being questioned everywhere, and we are the ones to prove what Islam is, to show what Islam is, to explain what Islam is, and by our examples, by our sharing, and by our discussions and with others, we give the image of Islam, which is a very high responsibility that, you know, everything that we do, people make conclusions about it. That so-and-so, I know so-and-so, I know this student, this person, this neighbor, this is what Islam is all about. So when we think about it, we're very unique. And Allah has given us very unique opportunity to be living in this kind of society at this time and age. And then when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us about what kind of people we are, what kind of ummah we are, you know, that puts a lot of responsibility. When Allah says, كُنْتُمْ خَيْرَ أُمَّةٍ أُخْرِجَتْ لِلنَّاسِ تَعْمُرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَتَنْهَوْنَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ وَتُؤْمِنُونَ بِاللَّهِ You are the best community of believers who have been brought out to enjoin the good and forbid the evil and to believe in Allah. You are the best ummah when Allah addresses us. And when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that وَكَذَلِكَ جَعَلْنَاكُمْ أُمَّةً وَسَطًا لِتَكُونُوا شُهَدَاءَ عَلَى النَّاسِ وَيَكُونَ الرَّسُولُ عَلَيْكُمْ شَهِيدًا that as such we have made you a nation of an ummah of wasat so that you are witnesses on mankind, on human beings as Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam as the messenger was a witness on us. So as Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam practiced Islam and taught Islam in its purest form and he became a real witness for all of us, now we are witnesses and to mankind, all people of different backgrounds and nationalities and religions to present Islam to them. And we are the Ummah Wasat. Ummah Wasat in Arabic also has connotation of not only centrality, but point of balance, point of moderation. So we are supposed to be in the center of all humanity. Our role should be central so that all the human beings revolve around us, around Muslims, around the Ummah of Islam. That's the kind of role that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us. And with such a role, when we try to translate this role into our community, that our community in North America living here as Muslims, we have to reach that level. And as an individual, each one of us, that I am supposed to be the central person, whoever lives around me in my neighborhood, Whoever goes in the sits in the class with me in the college, whoever is friends with me in any other circle, I have to be the central person as a Muslim among them. Meaning that I have to inform them, enlighten them, I have to share with them the truth. I have to convey the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because I am the hearers and the inheritors of all the messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is a very heavy responsibility on our shoulders. And Allah has put us in such an environment and society where there is some relative level of openness that in general people listen, people hear, and individuals ask questions and they want to know about Islam. So each one of us in campuses, in workplace, in neighborhoods, wherever we are, it really makes us to think twice before we say something, before we do something, and it puts so much anxiety for us to develop our knowledge, to strengthen our knowledge so that we can really talk based on knowledge, so that we can truly share the true knowledge and the correct knowledge with other people. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us such a beautiful deen, such a logical deen, that when you present the deen to anybody, if they have used common sense approach, and if they are sincere, they will listen, and they will appreciate. So on one hand, we have the great deen. On the other hand, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has put us in a relatively open environment where people would listen, people would ask questions, people give you the chance. Today, this is an example of it, that we can get together, we can share with each other in a very open environment. Alhamdulillah, this is a blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the deen, the more we know it, the better and easier we can present it. Because deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is truly understandable for humanity. It's easy. I have been, alhamdulillah, involved in many so-called interfaith dialogues and programs that we have gone and people have stood up and presented their religions, and I can see in the body language of everybody else that they don't understand what the presenter is talking about. And a lot of times it's very hard for them to summarize their deen, to summarize their belief system, to summarize their practices. But as a Muslim, when you stand up and present Islam, the belief system, the practices, the principles and values, it's so easy for people to understand. Most of the people will tell you that, you know, I can just understand and follow because you're so structured, your deen is so structured and easy to understand. And that was the deen of Isa alayhi salam, the deen of Musa alayhi salam. But unfortunately, the teachings were changed, and nowadays they are confused and they don't know how to present the simple truth that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has conveyed. Yes, the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is truly very logical when it comes to faith. You know, faith, iman, aqidah is very important aspect of human life. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants human beings to develop faith individually and independently, and to question the faith of parents and question the faith of the society. Allah wants every human being to develop faith based on conviction, based on a rational and logical approach. Because if you are not convinced, and if you don't use the common sense approach to be convinced about your faith, you cannot simply practice it. You cannot pretend to practice it. You must be convinced, and your heart and mind should buy into it, that yes, it makes sense. Yes, it is the right deen. Yes, I want to not only myself practice it, but I want to share it with other people and other individuals that come across with me, because it really is something useful for me and for others. You know, the faith, the iman part, the faith is, while we believe in certain aspects of unseen, you know, we don't see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we don't see the angels, but we believe in them. We don't see the Jannah and Jahannam, but we believe in them. But this faith is different. This faith in unseen is not what is called blind faith. You know, some people think that, okay, I have to blindly accept this and that. No, because there's a difference between blind faith and rational faith. The blind faith is the faith in something, believing in something that doesn't make sense. For example, Trinity. The concept of Trinity, putting three into one and one into three, and no matter how you define it, it doesn't make sense. You know, three is not equal to one, simple. But, Christian scholars also accept and this fact that, yes, you know, it may not necessarily make sense, but you have to accept it. It's a myth. At the bottom line, they will say it's a myth. You know, this is blind faith, to accept something that people say it's a myth. How could you base your life based on something which is a myth? Doesn't make sense. We don't do anything simple in our daily life without making sense to us. How could we accept a faith? But Islamic faith, even faith in unseen for us, is, while it's not positively proven faith that you can put it in the lab and see it, but it's a rational faith, meaning that it's based on intellectual evidence, based on rational evidence, and not necessarily relying on physical terms. For example, you know, we believe that in an atom there is protons, there is neutrons, and there is electrons. You know, not all of us go in the lab and see it. When we read in the biology book and chemistry book, we accept it, and it makes sense that, yes, atom is made of these components. It makes sense to accept it. The same way when we hear about angels, about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, it makes sense to accept it, the Jannah and Jahannam. It's logical. It's the most sensible and the most reasonable belief system, because in physical terms, you cannot neither prove or unprove it if you try, but it makes sense when you accept it. And you don't question it. Some people may say, well, there are some scientists who have looked at the components of atom in the lab. The same way we have expert witnesses, the messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they were exposed to the realities of unseen. Ibrahim alayhi salam was given the example of the birds, you know, that he put all these birds and killed them, and then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, okay, put all their bones and everything together. You know the story in Surah Al-Baqarah, that they all, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made them alive again in front of him, so he showed them the life after death. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was taken to heaven to see the Jannah and Jahannam, and all the some of the hidden things that generally human beings are not exposed to. So we have also expert witnesses, just like some scientists in the lab who have proven and seen the components of atom. We have those expert witnesses that we can rely and depend on as messengers of Allah, more than a human being, more than a scientist. So that the faith itself is based on this intellectual evidence and rational evidence. And it's very important that in Islam, we should take faith based on rational approach. Because if you take faith as in a blind way, then you will not be able to practice it. You will live as marginal Muslim. And you will pretend as Muslim sometimes, and some other times you just expose your true identity that you practice non-Islamic things. So it's for all of us, especially as students of Islam and as a people of knowledge, that we have to convince ourselves deep down in the heart and in the mind that this faith makes sense. And this faith is based on wisdom, based on logic, based on rationale. And once we reach that point, then we submit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And submission will be a full submission, that then that submission leads us to practice, to follow Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and follow Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then you will follow without questioning, although you like to know the reasons for some of the commands, but it's not a prerequisite anymore because you've already submitted yourself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is very important for all of us to develop faith individually, independently. Even though we are born in Muslim families and we have taken faith from our parents, but at some point we have to question it. Is it really true? Is it really logical? Should I really give my life for this kind of faith? Should I really, stand and defend it with all of my energy and talent and resources that Allah has given me? And inshallah, once we reach that point that yes, I'm deeply convinced that this faith really makes sense and this faith is really beneficial for me and for you, other human beings, then we start sharing this faith with others, and we ourselves will really exemplify the faith of Islam in our lives, that so that we can become, inshallah, sources of like lights and enlighten other people and enlighten the society with the truth of Islamic faith. Unfortunately, the reality is that most of the people, most of the human beings, they accept faith blindly. And then when it comes to practices, when it comes to commands of Allah and Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then they question. Then they question each command, and then they accept only those commands that make sense to them and reject the other commands. Say, oh, I'm not convinced with this command, with this command. Well, if we have truly submitted ourselves, if we have truly understood that Allah says the truth, Allah is the truth, and the Prophet, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, was really a genuine prophet, and he really brought everything from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then it's enough for us to start practicing. And then once as we start practicing, we will see the benefits, we will see the reasons, we will see the logic comes after practicing, because Allah enlightens us after that to see a lot of reasons. Now, with this kind of faith and with this kind of society that we live here, alhamdulillah, it is really a win-win situation when you think about it. Because each one of us are having, alhamdulillah, the opportunity for learning, the opportunity for sharing, the opportunity for even trying to convince others for the faith. In this world, as we know, in the contemporary society, people look at life and can divide it into two segments. They make life into a carnal, a worldly aspect. They divide life into two segments, a personal life and a social life, communal life. In personal life, they divide it into two segments. They say one aspect is carnal, worldly, secular, and the other aspect is spiritual in personal life. And then in social life, they say economic aspect of life, political aspects of life, all the other aspects of life. In communal life, they say it has nothing to do with religion. And even in personal life, they say there's a lot of aspects of life which is carnal, worldly. And then when it comes to spiritual aspects of life, they only certain rituals and certain actions are considered as acts of religion. And it becomes too personal and too limited, certain morals and some certain rituals and a personal relationship between human beings and God, and that's it. While when you look at the faith of Islam, it is a comprehensive system that tells us about every aspect of our life, whether it's personal life, whether it's social life, whether it's moral life, whether it's psychological aspects of our life, economical aspects, political aspects, every aspect of life. So it's truly a way of life that makes sense to understand it and to make efforts to understand it and share it with others and become ambassadors of this deen of Islam in this land in particular. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has offered us the concept of ilm and hikmah. Ilm, the knowledge that we learn and through school, through colleges, but then in particular knowledge of deen that we learn through certain sources, authentic sources, Quran and authentic hadith, and scholars who have really established themselves. And then the hikmah, which is basically the wisdom how to use this knowledge. That wisdom itself becomes a specific area of knowledge to develop it, to increase it, and to use it as a means of using the knowledge, to say the right thing at the right place and in the right manner and in the right time. To do something in the right time, in the right manner, as Ibn al-Qayyum al-Jawziyah defines this in Madaraj al-Salikin. And also he defines it, he gives a scientific definition for hikmah, that wisdom is basically the knowledge of relating things, relating the cause and effect, relating the results with causes. And from not only a physical composition of matter, but also from the Sharia, using the Sharia laws, using the laws, revealed laws, and also using the laws of nature that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when you use all these different knowledges that are given, and you make decisions, and you make judgment, that's hikmah, that's wisdom. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam very beautifully, in one hadith which is reported in Tirmizi, says that wisdom is like a precious commodity that is lost. And a believer must always search for it. And wherever a believer finds it, must act upon and upon it, however it dictates. So wisdom is really something that Muslims are all be after. And true believers are all after to find it and to use it. And also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala explains this concept of wisdom and hikmah, that it is something that's plenty of khayr in it, plenty of goodness in it. Allah says, وَمَنْ يُؤْتَ الْحِكْمَةَ فَقَدْ أُوْتِيَ خَيْرًا كَثِيرًا. Whoever is given hikmah, wisdom, indeed he has been given plenty of khayr, plenty of goodness. So this is something that we are all after, to find the hikmah, to develop the hikmah, to strengthen the hikmah, and use it in sharing the knowledge. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Udu ila sabili rabbika bil hikmati wal ma'izati al hasana." Call people towards the path of Allah using the hikmah, using the wisdom, because with wisdom you can really understand how to say it, when to say it, how to call others towards Islam, how to invite even other people, Muslims who are not practicing Islam, towards practicing Islam. And it's all a comprehensive system of methodology that gives you specific formulas, how to deal with other Muslims, how to deal with Ahl al-Kitab, how to deal with non-Muslims, atheists, and different backgrounds that people have. Now, with that insight, we go after knowledge. We go after knowledge, but knowledge comes with taqwa. And in knowledge, true knowledge comes based on taqwa. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ وَيُعَلِّمُكُمُ اللَّهُ وَاللَّهُ بِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ عَلِيمٌ. Be conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Have taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you have taqwa, Allah will teach you the knowledge. Allah will give you the knowledge. And Allah is indeed fully knowledgeable about everything. And another place Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِن تَتَّقُوا اللَّهَ يَجْعَلْ لَكُمْ فُرْقَانًا. If you, O believers, if you take the path of taqwa, Allah will give you the criterion to make to distinguish between wrong and right. Beyond the five senses, beyond the resources and abilities that all human beings have, if you seek knowledge based on taqwa, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give you some additional qualifications and qualities that you could discern. You could really distinguish this is right or wrong. Other people cannot tell, but you can tell, and you can easily make decisions based on that. And that comes based on taqwa, when you seek knowledge based on taqwa. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has encouraged us so much to go after knowledge, that he says that one who goes after knowledge, follows the path of knowledge, Allah makes his path for towards paradise easy for him. Now, dear brothers and sisters, I know all of you, alhamdulillah, are in the path of knowledge. And all of you are studying hard in the university. And all of you also, I'm sure, you want to do more Islamic studies. And there are now questions how to do it. Well, first of all, as soon as we think of Islamic studies, unfortunately, there's a lot of negative reactions from the families. Isn't that true? A lot of sometimes our parents, in our family circles, people question, what? You want to do Islamic studies? What do you do with Islamic studies, you know? You want to become a mullah? You want to become a, why don't you want to become an engineer, a doctor? Why don't you become a this and that? So we have to overcome first these issues with the family to convince them that Islamic studies is important for me, for family, for the society, for everybody. And you really, you know, when you overcome this issue, and it may take a long time sometimes, you know, so that they will accept you that, yes, you can do Islamic studies. Now we question how. There are different routes to do Islamic studies in this environment that we are. You can do Islamic studies just bits and pieces here and there. These different institutions, Al-Maghreb, Al-Madina, Zaytuna, you know, they offer weekend programs, they offer summer programs, they offer a couple hours of lectures, places. Great. We can benefit from it while we are doing a lot of other things and studies. And that's one way to, inshallah, develop and study and get some books and read and question, ask the questions from imams, from scholars. That's one route. Another route is to say that, okay, I'm going to do serious Islamic studies on a continuous basis besides my current education and career. That's also possible. You can join some institutions. You can join some online programs. You can join some universities. And, you know, you can do both, but it's difficult and hard, but it's possible. Another route is that some students have done in America, that they say, okay, I stop all of my studies and my work. I go for a couple years or a few years to either overseas or join here some Islamic institutes and universities, and I do some studies. And alhamdulillah, many people who have done that, they're happy and they come back and bring a lot of knowledge with them, and they really are beneficial to our communities and to American environment in general. And that's possible. But again, it's, there are issues and obstacles. Issues are that first, it's not easy to go overseas. You know, you have to wait for a long time. You have to apply to different universities and programs. And you may not be selected. And you may be discouraged for years. You may have to wait sometimes. And also, sometimes when you go there, you may get disappointed if you are not going to the right program and right university. And then here, we have some institutions and some programs that are not developed as well as you want, but there are some programs. And then you say, okay, another route is that I want to do Islamic studies to do the American universities. And, you know, many, many universities, they have Islamic studies now department. They have Islamic studies as a major or as a minor, including George Mason. You know, they have a minor in Islamic studies. But then when you talk to the professors, when you see the curriculum, you know, you may get discouraged. Because you see the professors, they are not practicing Muslims most of the time. You see that they have strange thoughts and ideas. And you see some people who are completely secular, they teach Islam, or even non-Muslims, biased and hostile to Islam, but they teach Islam. And so you have to be extra, extra careful if you join these Islamic studies programs. And don't go just because the name of it is Islamic studies, or this university offers Islamic studies, that university offers Islamic universities. No. Because I myself, you know, I visited more than 10 universities in America, and I talked to different professors, both for my master's and my PhD, and I was just not convinced that when I talked to the professors and when I saw the programs. But alhamdulillah, recently, there are some good programs. There are some professors, individuals here and there who have started. And if you can join some of those programs, there are some. But the point is that you want to develop your knowledge through your imam, through your real scholars that you trust them. And then you do these additional Islamic studies in the universities. Because they assume if you don't have some strong background and Islamic knowledge yourself, when you go to these universities in America, you may really sometimes get confused, sometimes may get discouraged to do Islamic studies, and sometimes it may even change your faith and your ideas, and you be, it will have negative consequences. So you have to be extra, extra careful, inshallah, to do Islamic studies in the universities. But there are options. There are some universities who offer. Now, of course, you make a lot of dua and you make a lot of consultations with other imams, with other people that they have knowledge and they have gone through the experience. And that's a lot of times you may find some easy routes and some more appropriate routes through consultations. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, through continuous dua, will really, inshallah, show the way, will find the way whoever is really after Islamic knowledge, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will definitely guide him, it's going to happen, but sometimes with some hardships, sometimes with some sacrifices. And this path is path of sacrifice. Once you get these degrees, then you ask, okay, what can I do with these degrees? With Islamic studies degrees, what can I do? And parents also ask you, what do you do with Islamic studies degrees? And it's a good question. In terms of careers, the options are there, but they are limited. Some options are teaching in these Islamic institutes. You know, there are more and more these institutes like Al-Maghrib, Al-Bayina, Al-Madina, and these they will grow and they will see in the next few years much more of this. So each of them offers opportunities for teaching Islam, and you can teach there. Besides that, there is imams positions or teaching in the Islamic full-time schools, primary schools or elementary schools or high schools even. You can teach there, becoming principal, becoming teachers, other. These are also options. But the ideal option, I think, for most of us that we should target is to teach in the universities. To go after PhD, and once you get your PhD, you're qualified to teach. And that's a great career option, to be a professor in the university, and inshallah, to really share the knowledge with non-Muslims and with Muslims. And so these are different, some possible options of careers at this time, but inshallah in the future, more and more Islamic organizations are to be developed and to provide more opportunities. But you will, even if you cannot teach officially in the university or anything, you can be a da'iya, you can be a real, from the du'at. You know, you can really call people and make that as your mission, that I want to, inshallah, call people towards Allah. This is my duty. This is my permanent full-time job. And whether I'm an engineer, whether I'm a doctor, whether I'm a lawyer, I will focus on da'wah. And that is a real career. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he says, وَمَنْ أَحْسَنُ قَوْلًا مِمَّنْ دَعَى إِلَى اللَّهِ وَعَمِلَ صَالِحًا وَقَالَ إِنَّنِي مِنَ الْمُسْلِمِينَ. When Allah says that, who is better in a speech than the person who calls people towards Allah? Basically, this is the best. Allah says this is the best career, that you want to be a person of da'wah. You want to really call people towards Islam, and you want to live in this. And this career option is the best and ideal option that we all can have easily without any strings attached to it and difficulties. Of course, difficulties in terms of da'wah will come, but we can, inshallah, really do a lot of work, and we are really needed. Brothers and sisters, if we don't do da'wah work, if we just say that I'm an average Muslim and I just care about myself and I just want to be a good Muslim myself, that's really sad, because if we are a truly ummah wasat, central ummah, if we're really people that we want to be khayr ummah, the best nation, the best community, then we really have to work hard to stand for this deen and share this deen. And inshallah, through us, maybe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will open the hearts and minds of many, many people. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us and guide us in this path, and support us and show us the truth as the truth, and show us the falsehood as the falsehood, and put blessings in our efforts. Ameen ya Rabbul Alameen. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.